Lion Cove, Skymont, XE2 Battlemage, N3B Process Node. Lunar Lake might be a tiny chip, but it's filled with new technology. And when I say new technology, I don't mean slight iterations of existing hardware. We're talking about substantial changes to almost the entire architecture. Intel invited me and more than 200 other press and media to a pre-Computex event in Taipei, where we got detailed information about Lunar Lake and had the opportunity to speak with the engineers that worked on its design. Full disclosure, because transparency is important to me. Intel paid for the flights and the hotel during the event. There was no influence over the contents of this video, Intel didn't get to see it before release, and I wasn't even required to make one. So without further ado, let's go on a deep dive into Lunar Lake. Lunar Lake is the successor to Meteor Lake, and just like Meteor Lake, it's a mobile-only SoC, targeting the new AI PC product category. And yes, no one likes that name. But if you can see past the marketing, there's a lot of exciting technology inside the silicon, and outside too. Looking at the Lunar Lake package, we can see the on-package memory, similar to what Apple is doing with their M-series SoCs. Lunar Lake comes with either 16 or 32 GB of low-power DDR5X 8533. Placing the memory on the same package as the SoC not only reduces the form factor size, it also comes with pretty substantial efficiency improvements. A huge boon for a chip that targets thin and light systems. But it does come at the cost of upgradability. Just like with Apple, you won't be able to upgrade your DRAM after the fact, something to keep in mind. Right below the memory chips, we can see the actual silicon. Like Meteor Lake, Lunar Lake uses a tile-based design, which is how Intel calls their chiplet architecture. Just by looking at it, we can make out three different tiles. The largest one, the so-called compute tile, has a die size of about 140 square millimeters. It's produced in TSMC's N3B process node and contains all the core functions, such as CPU, GPU, NPU, and memory controller. The smaller 40 to 50 mm² rectangular die is the platform controller tile and contains most of the connectivity IP, such as PCI Express Gen 4 and 5, USB, Thunderbolt, Wi-Fi 7, Bluetooth, and so on. Because these parts don't scale well with modern process nodes, the platform controller tile is manufactured in TSMC's N6 node. The third visible tile, the tiny square, doesn't contain any transistors at all. It's structural support to create a coherent silicon surface. But there's a fourth tile, which we can't see because it's hidden underneath the top tiles, fittingly called the base tile. It's a silicon interposer produced in Intel's 22 FFN node, internally named P1227.1. The base tile is what enables the forward die-to-die interconnect, something I've extensively covered in my Meteor Lake deep dive video. It's a low latency and power efficient interconnect. Lunar Lake is using the newest iteration called Forest Omni, which enables a 25 micron bump pitch and thus further increases the energy efficiency compared to the 36 microns bump pitch used in Meteor Lake. But the on-package memory and the tile-based design is only the beginning. In order to uncover the truly interesting changes like new CPU and GPU cores, we have to take a look inside the silicon. While we don't have access to a real die shot yet, Intel provided a precise visual representation. And at this point in time, I have no reason to doubt that this is how the layout actually looks like. Let's label the individual areas first before diving into the technical aspects of the architecture. At the top of the compute tile, we can find the physical layer of the memory interface. It's a dual channel configuration and each channel can address 4 times 16 bits for a combined 128 bit. The interface is located in this part of the compute tile because it's the closest physical location to the on-package memory. The CPU performance cores are located on the right side of the chip, below the memory interface. 4 Lion Cove P cores are attached to 12 MB shared L3 cache. Next, the Skymont E cores can be found a little bit to the left, with another 4 CPU cores clustered around 4 MB shared L2 cache, which looks like a cross. If you have watched any of my previous Intel-focused chip deep dives, you might already notice a substantial difference regarding the layout of P and E cores. Above the E cores and next to the P cores is a rather large block of cache, not that much smaller than the E core cluster, something we haven't seen on an Intel chip before. We will discuss its function later in this video. The neural processing unit in its fourth iteration, thus called NPU4, can be found to the left of the E cores. It takes up a substantial amount of die area. Not as much as the P cores, but more than twice the area of the E cores, an indication of its importance. The MPU contains 6 so-called neural compute engines. The largest single area of the compute tile is the GPU, on the far left side. It contains 8 new Xe2 GPU cores, the architecture behind Battlemage. 4 cores are located above and below a 8 MB shared L2 cache. The compute tile also contains media and display engines, and a new IP-agnostic interconnect that runs through the center of the compute tile down to the platform controller tile. Looking at the annotated compute tile, I'm getting strong ARM vibes. Lunar Lake does look a lot like many mobile-focused ARM chips, for example Apple's M-series. Performance and efficiency cores are separated. There's a large cache that's seemingly not connected to a specific function unit, like a SLC cache. There's a huge GPU that takes up the majority of the die, a big NPU, and prominent media and display engines alongside a wide and fast low-power DDR5X memory interface. The layout looks unlike anything Intel has ever designed. It's also interesting to see that whereas Meteor Lake used different tiles for CPU, GPU, NPU, and memory, Lunar Lake is going back to an almost monolithic approach, only separating some of the I/O in the platform controller tile. Now that we have an overview of the layout inside the Lunar Lake compute tile, let's take a closer look at the architecture changes. I'll focus on CPU and GPU, but we'll also take a short look at what's new with the NPU. Let's start with the Lion Cove P cores. To address the elephant in the room, the Lion Cove microarchitecture does not remove the support for hyperthreading. But the version of Lion Cove that's used in Lunar Lake only has one thread per core. Let me explain. With previous generations, architecture and cores were mostly synonymous. There always have been slight differences between implementations of the same architecture in different products, for example cache size. But by and large, if you see a Golden Cove core, there won't be a huge difference to another Golden Cove core on a different chip. This changes with Lion Cove. Instead of referring to a specific core, Lion Cove is more of an umbrella term for different implementations of the same overarching architecture. At its core, Lion Cove introduces a substantial overhaul of the microarchitecture. The frontend is faster and wider, and the out-of-order engine has been split into different domains for integer and vectors. There are more integer and SIMD ALUs and an overhauled cache system. Previous Intel core architectures used a traditional L1 and L2 cache hierarchy. Lion Cove is introducing a third cache stage, although I don't like the name Intel is using for it. Compared to Redwood and Raptor Cove, Lion Cove adds a new L0 cache, but if you look at the numbers, it's the same 48 KB L1 cache just with a faster 4-cycle latency. I don't know why Intel thought it would be a good idea to rename the L1 cache to L0. Lion Cove also increases the L2 cache size to either 2.5 or 3 MB, depending on the core type. Lunar Lake is using the 2.5 MB variant. With the increase in size comes a slight increase in latency, from 16 to 17 cycles. The new cache sits in between the former L1 and L2. It's 192 KB at 9 cycles. This third stage offers a nice intermediate option between the previous L1 and L2 cache. A much more fitting name would be L1.5 cache, because that's exactly what it is. The L1.5 cache will speed up code that doesn't need the huge 2.5 MB L2 cache, but is too large for the small 48 KB L1 cache. There are many more microarchitectural changes, but I'll leave it to the pros at Chips and Cheese or Anantech to explain them in detail. In a nutshell, the microarchitecture of Lion Cove is wider, faster, and more power efficient. Intel claims a 14% IPC increase over Redwood Cove, which has a very similar IPC to Raptor Cove. And while it is far from what some of the more out there rumors claimed, 14% more IPC over the already powerful previous generation is a very strong result. Keep in mind, this is Lion Cove in Lunar Lake. Lion Cove in Arrow Lake, with the bigger 3 MB L2 cache and a much larger shared L3 cache, will very likely offer an even higher IPC. And then there are the new Lion Cove building blocks. Intel didn't go into much detail, but from what I could understand, there are a couple of features that you can choose from when implementing a CPU core based on the Lion Cove architecture. This includes AVX512 and hyperthreading, and Lion Cove in Lunar Lake removed both of them. It's not just turned off, it doesn't exist in hardware. But why remove hyperthreading from Lunar Lake? There is more than one reason. Hyperthreading, or SMT in general, can be very efficient if it is used. And the focus here is on if. The way it works is you spend around 5-10% more transistors on each core, which allows you to run 2 threads on a single core. This increases multi-thread performance by up to 30%, but also increases power consumption by about 20%. Most of the time, that's an easy decision. Achieving 30% higher performance with just 10% more transistors at 20% higher power draw is a no-brainer. It actually increases area and power efficiency, but it also increases the total area and total power consumption. And if area and power budget are limited, there are trade-offs to consider. Ever since the introduction of P&E cores with Alder Lake, Intel's Threat Director is in charge of allocating threats. Until now, the Threat Director had three different types of threats to consider: P-core threats, E-core threats, and P-core SMT threats. If you optimize for performance, the Threat Director prioritizes P-core threats, then E-core threats, and SMT threats last. The same is true when you optimize for efficiency. Here the E-cores come first, then P-cores, and SMT threats are again last. In many use cases, hyperthreading isn't used because SMT threats are only utilized when both P and E cores are at full load, but the additional transistors still take up valuable silicon area and increase power consumption even when you aren't using them. In a nutshell, Intel looked at the pros and cons of hyperthreading and came to the conclusion that for Lunar Lake, the downsides outweigh the upsides. As you can guess, that conclusion will be different for server CPUs, which need SMT to achieve high multi-thread performance. There is no official information on Arrow Lake, which might or might not offer SMT. There might even be differences between mobile and desktop parts, but that's pure speculation on my side. So no, Lion Cove does not remove hyperthreading. Lunar Lake does. Next are the SkyMont E-cores. The first thing I noticed is that the E-cores are not connected to the same interconnect fabric as the P-cores and thus don't have access to the shared L3 cache, a massive change over Intel's previous hybrid CPU architectures. In Lunar Lake, the E-core cluster is its own separate area. Intel calls it a low-power island. But believe me, SkyMont is anything but low-power. SkyMont is a much wider design than its predecessors, Gracemont and Crestmont. Decode went from 6-wide to 9-wide in a 3x3 configuration. The out-of-order engine has a 8-wide allocation port, which in fact makes SkyMont a 8-wide design overall, same as Lion Cove and wider than Zen 4. Again, I'll leave the in-depth microarchitecture analysis to the experts, but there's no doubt, SkyMont is a massive upgrade. Intel reports a 38% increase in integer IPC and a whopping 68% uplift in floating point IPC. The last time we saw similar numbers was when AMD introduced the original Zen back in 2017. And it does show in the size comparisons between P and E cores. Previously, one P core was 3.78 times the size of one E core. Now it's down to only about 3x. But there's still a mystery at hand. A wide and faster core also needs more and faster cache. But there's still only 4 MB of shared L2 cache on the E-core cluster. And with the removal from the P-core fabric, the E-cores lost access to the shared L3 cache. What's going on here? The answer is the standalone cache. When I first saw it, I was immediately thinking Apple SLC cache. And that's basically what it is. Intel calls it memory side cache. It's an additional 8 MB of cache that can be accessed by much of the compute tile, but is primarily used by the E-cores and the NPU. Without the memory side cache, the powerful SkyMont E-cores would be cache starved, and at the same time, it can be used to increase performance and efficiency of other components. I've already mentioned the NPU, and the media engine also benefits from the extra cache. In theory, P-cores and CPU can also access the memory side cache, but from what I understand, it's not really needed because both already have plenty of cache available. Circling back to the term low power island, I want to touch on another reason why Intel separated P and E cores. Lunar Lake has 4 independent so-called PMIC, which is short for Power Management Integrated Circuit. These 4 PMIC are responsible for different areas of the die. One PMIC for the P-core cluster, one for the E-core cluster, and one for the GPU. The rest of the die is controlled by a single PMIC. This means the CPU clusters can be completely switched off when they aren't used. And because the E-cores are much more powerful and have access to the new memory side cache, the P-cores are actually switched off during a lot of workloads. That's why the E-cores are isolated from the P-cores. But this implementation is again unique to Lunar Lake. Other CPUs will still combine Lion Cove P-core and SkyMont E-cores into a single CPU cluster, where all cores are connected to the same ring bus and have access to the same shared L3 cache. As a teaser, Intel showed an IPC comparison between a SkyMont E-core attached to the P-core fabric and the shared L3 cache. This has to be an Arrow Lake test chip. The results are mind-blowing. When connected to the fabric, SkyMont achieves a higher average IPC than Raptor Cove. It's not across all workloads, the IPC has a slight S-curve, but there are also clear wins. I would have never expected that the E-cores in Arrow Lake have a higher IPC than the P-cores in Raptor Lake. Absolutely crazy. But keep in mind that this is just an IPC comparison. The differences in clock speed will still result in a clear performance difference. and DE cores in Lunar Lake will have a slightly lower IPC, since they are not connected to the shared L3 cache like on Arrow Lake. The CPU cores aren't the only new thing in Lunar Lake. It's also the first time we are seeing Intel's second-gen Xe graphics architecture. Xe2, which will also power Battle Mage, is a substantial upgrade over Alchemist. Intel identified existing bottlenecks and achieved a large performance uplift, while at the same time increasing compatibility with games, which might be even more important. Alchemist did struggle with some especially older games. Gaming performance increased by around 50% over the previous Meteor Lake generation, with further improved ray tracing capabilities. All of this while Lunar Lake still has 8 Xe cores. The fast 128-bit low-power DDR5X memory interface should help with gaming performance, and I'd also like to see the GPU take advantage of the memory side cache if the E cores aren't in use. Again, I'm not smart enough for GPU microarchitecture. All I can do is show you the slides. Another focus for the Xe2 GPU are the Vector and XMX units for AI and machine learning. Xe2 adds SIMD16 ALUs and support for a wide range of math formats. The GPU in Lunar Lake achieves a peak of 67 TOPS and 8, which is really strong for such a small GPU. Last but certainly not least, there is the NPU. You might ask why there is a dedicated NPU if the GPU already achieves 67 TOPS. And it gets even more strange when you consider that the NPU only has a peak output of 48 TOPS. But GPU and NPU have very different jobs. The GPU is a graphics card with added AI capabilities, just like the CPU cores are also capable of running AI. It offers a higher peak performance, but also consumes more power and takes up more silicon area. The GPU is more geared toward actively using AI as a creator or in games, when you don't mind the added power draw. NPU and GPU are a bit like E and P cores in that regard. When you are using basic machine learning applications, like a background blur for video calls or AI assistants, you don't want to stress your GPU. That's when the NPU comes in. The overall goal of Lunar Lake is that for a majority of tasks, you can rely on the efficient E cores and NPU. P cores and GPU are only activated when you really need the extra performance. The NPU4 in Lunar Lake offers a major performance uplift over the previous NPU3 in Meteor Lake, by adding more engines, increasing frequency, and improving the architecture at the same time. If you combine NPU, GPU, and CPU, Lunar Lake offers a platform performance of 120 TOPS and 8, outclassing all other current solutions on the market. Lunar Lake is so interesting because it combines next-gen IP with a truly unique design. Lion Cove, Skymont, and XE2 Battle Mage are first in Lunar Lake, and all three offer substantial architectural improvements. Lion Cove adds a whopping 14% IPC on top of the already powerful Redbrook Cove, while being more power efficient. XE2 learned from Alchemist's mistakes and not only offers better performance, but more importantly, a more mature and compatible architecture. And Skymont is in a class of its own, offering P-core-like IPC in a tiny form factor. But Lunar Lake also takes a page out of the ARM playbook, which means no hyperthreading for the P-cores, separate power islands for the E-cores, a memory side cache that functions almost like a system-level cache, a powerful NPU, and all of that in a leading-edge 3-nanometer node. And all of that shows in the silicon. From a high-level overview, Lunar Lake's compute tile looks more like a mobile ARM SoC than Meteor Lake. All of Intel's design decisions are represented in the silicon itself. If someone would have shown me this very visual representation of Lunar Lake without telling me what chip it is, I would have never guessed that I'm looking at an Intel chip. And that's exciting, not because Intel chips can't be good, but because Intel is actually trying something new. From an architectural and silicon point of view, Lunar Lake is by far the most interesting chip in a while. Now all we have to do is wait and see if Intel can actually deliver. If Lunar Lake is able to hold up to its promise, we might see a shift in the whole ARM versus x86 debate. I hope you found this video interesting, and see you in the next one.